Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for just being able to be here tonight. And I pray, God, that you would please help us to listen tonight, because we're expecting you to change our lives. And I pray, God, that in every part of tonight, you would be working. And I pray that your word, as it goes out, won't return to you empty, that it will come back tonight to you with lives changed. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Every day you walk past so many logos and so many symbols that you don't even notice them anymore. There are some logos that you just so innately know exist that you kind of see all the time. And you just kind of, they just immediately know what they are. You're so familiar with them, right? So those kind of logos that kind of go through, it's fascinating how many of them. Some of you are probably wearing some on you right now, right? And so those logos kind of come all the time. So here's the deal, right? Some logos are super, super, super recognizable. So I thought we might play a game tonight. You up for a game, MBM, 6pm? You up for a game? All right, so here's what we're going to do. Here's what we're going to do. He's up for a game. Okay, here's what we're going to do. I'm going to flash a whole stack of logos in the space of like 3 seconds on the screen. And I want you to stare at the screen, and I want you to look really carefully and see how many logos you recognize in the space of three. I'm just like, I think there's like, I don't know, like 16 logos. I don't know how many are, something like that, on there. So I don't even know what that looks like and how many that is per second. I'm Asian. I should be good at maths. I should know how to do this. Anyway, they'll be coming pretty quick. That's the answer. They'll be coming quick is the answer. So here's the deal. You guys ready to play? We'll play the logo recognition game. Everyone blink your eyes. Come on, get ready, get ready. You're going to have to stare really sharp. Here we go. Let's go. There's a little video to play. 3 seconds. Ready? Blink, blink, blink. Go. Oh! Who reckons I got more than three? Who reckons I got more than five of those things? Who reckons I got more than six of those things? Man, that's impressive. Very, very good. Let me tell you. Show up the next slide. This is some of the logos that were up. And you'll see, man, there they are. Here they are. And like, you know that some of these things are very, 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 very familiar to you. And so, I mean, all of you have that Instagram logo burned into your mind, or Facebook. You guys are on it way too much. And we're all on it too much. And so you know those things move quick. And some logos are just so recognizable that you don't even, I mean, like, I mean, all it, Batman. If you don't know the Batman one, then your life is not complete. You have missed out a big part of your life. So these things are just so innate. So some logos are just so quick. They come past. You just like recognize them instantly. You don't even think twice about them. Some logos, some of the really cool logos, if you stop and pause on a logo and you kind of look a little bit deeper into the logo, there's kind of deeper meanings, hidden meanings inside the logo. And I think they're kind of really interesting because you kind of just look at them and you don't even think twice. So for example, right, this is a website here, put it up, that Dave Jensen uses a lot. No. This is mostly a girl's website. I don't even know what this thing is. Is it not? Is it? It's beautiful. I'm getting some girls going, yes. I don't know what it is, but you know what? Pinterest, as you can see, the P is in the shape of a pin. So for example, you can see it's kind of all embedded in there. Or for example, this one, right? Here's another logo that you might want to just pause on. So like this is just FedEx, right? So they, you know, these guys are amazing. I mean, you might know that their main aim is to move stuff from here towards here, which is why I'm sure you've seen the arrow that's just in between the E and the X right there. You see that? Wow, there it is. Everyone go. On the count of three, everyone go, whoa, ready? One, two, three, go. Whoa, that's cool. I mean, like, you see, you would have just, I just see that a million times, right? Like, blue label, blue word, orange word. Now, everyone's still trying to point it out. The arrow right there, see the arrow? There it is. So everyone's like, I just see it's like a blue word, orange word, and you just think, man, no way. Like if you just, you would never stop to look at that twice, but when you stop and look a bit deeper, there it is. Or for example, a logo that you guys know so well, because I'm sure you've ordered stuff off it, is this, Amazon, which is, you know, this company, they are amazing, and they pride themselves in being able to sell anything from A to Z, which is why the arrow goes from A to Z. See that? Wow, there it is, man. It's all there. And there it is, the Amazon. Everyone, one, two, three. Oh, there it is, A to Z. And so you can see Amazon, that's what they do. And so you look quietly longer and you think, no way, that's there. Or the next The next one, is there another one? I forgot now. Yeah. Oh, Baskin-Robbins, right, which I didn't know this about the company. You have to know this to kind of have your awe moment. But Baskin-Robbins, apparently, since its founding of Baskin-Robbins, even today, if you go to a Baskin-Robbins shop, they say their big thing is they only sell 31 flavors of ice cream every single time. 31 flavors is why the 31 is right in the middle of the Baskin and Robbins word right there. So there it is. And so there's all these funny things, these kind of, you know, ice cream will never be the same for me now. I just go to Baskin Robbins and go, man, I know, 31, there is a 3 and the 1. And so there's all these different things, these different logos, where different symbols that if you stop and you kind of just look a little deeper, you kind of go, man, there's a meaning that's beyond that, beyond just quick recognizing kind of ability. How about this one? Hands down, the most recognizable symbol on the planet. Hands down, the most significant and important symbol on the planet. I was even looking for this symbol as I drove. There's, you know, crosses on churches all over the place, all over the world. This Easter, how many people are going to have that symbol or that, hear that talk about this symbol? How many people are going to let that cross across their mind and they're just going to go just like the start, like it's like, oh yeah, got it, yep, sure, the cross, Jesus died in it, you move on. How many of us are going to stop? Is tonight going to be a stop moment for you tonight? Is this Easter going to be a stop moment where you stop and you say, I refuse to just kind of think about this quickly. I want to find out the deeper meaning. I want to go deeper and deeper. And that's, and some of you right now are going, oh, I hope there's some newcomers come along and listen to this. No, I'm talking about you. I'm talking about all of you. What does it look like to go deeper, deeper into your understanding of the cross this Easter? Because in terms of multi-layered meanings, there is so much going on, and you spend a lifetime getting your head around the cross. You see, I'm convinced that you cannot understand the depths of the cross is Easter, and this Easter is going to be another one which just kind of blinks past you unless you understand how much you need that symbol, how much you need all that the cross represents. You got this really clearly? I'm going to put it really strong. Here it is. It's impossible to go deeper into your understanding of the cross without going deeper into your understanding for the need of the cross. Everyone with me? Who's with me? And so what I want to do is I want to start with our need. And I want us to understand, and I want us to go deeper. Don't kind of, no one tune out and go, yeah, I got it. Yeah, he's going to talk about sin. I am, right? I am. But don't let it go past. Go deeper in it, okay? Because you see, in this passage that was read for us, there's so much going on. And there's at least two groups of people before we even talk about the centerpiece. I'm going to talk about the centerpiece being this story about Barabbas. In a moment, first I'm going to start on either side of it because there's two groups on either side of Barabbas that I want to focus in on. It's kind of like a sandwich. We're going to talk about these two bits of bread until we get to the filling in the middle. So here's the first bit. The first group that's around the Barabbas story is the crowd. Now, I want you to understand this crowd, man, I don't know how you feel about this big mob at this trial scene, and they're there yelling out for the murder of Jesus. Just, you know how intense this crowd is and how they represent sin, really, is this. Look at this verse. This crowd is so full on. Look at this. Pilate's trying to, at the moment, proclaim Jesus' innocence. And in verse 23, but with loud shouts, so the crowd is just shouting. They're not even just suggesting. So look, I'm really not sure about this Jesus guy. They're shouting over Pilate, and then with loud shouts, they insistently demanded, not just a little suggestion, they keep demanding that Jesus be crucified. And their shouts continued, the shouts prevailed on and on and on and on. And you look at this mob and you think, this is horrendous. How can these guys do this? I mean, and they're so fickle, right? I mean, look at this crowd. This crowd in this story, unbelievable. Moments ago, well, not moments, but really, you've seen this crowd all the way through Luke, and they're happy with Jesus as long as they're getting the good stuff, right? The miracles are happening, no problem. Feed the 5,000, very happy with that, you know? All those kind of things that are going on, the crowds there, they might even be the same crowd that yells out Hosanna and puts the palm leaves down. They may all be those kind of people. And then that voice is so fickle. And now that voice is calling out a different thing. Now that voice is calling out, crucify him, crucify him, crucify him. How does that work? Why is that happening? You know, the truth is, and this is going to be a hard part. This is my least favorite part of the sermon. It's my least. Do you know why? Because I feel really uncomfortable when I apply it to myself, and I'm going to. So I'm going to feel uncomfortable again, and you're not going to feel comfortable either. The truth is, we like to look at the crowd and sit above the crowd and say, there's no way I'd do that. And we like to look at them and say, there's no way I would get to the place where I'm effectively saying I don't want Jesus as part of my life. And the truth is, every one of us, says the Bible, every one of us has got ourselves to the position where we, and sin's the word, we choose to not have God in any part of our life, choose to not have Jesus over our life, to rule over our life, or at least we say we reserve parts that he can't touch. You know what I'm saying? Parts of our life, you can have our Sunday 6 p.m., but you can't have the rest of my life. And that's called sin. And that's the desperate, desperate situation we're in. We are actually in the crowd. I really believe we need to think about the fact that we are there in the crowd. But here's another crazy thing. Not only are we sinners, not only are we so in desperate need of a solution, here's the issue. That sin leads to somewhere. Now, here's a really interesting thing to think through. It's a bit of a kind of a mind-blowing moment for me for Easter. Because when I get to Good Friday, and boy, it's soon, by the way. It's really soon. Easter's soon. Hope you're zoning in for that. Because on Good Friday, I know there's going to be a whole lot of people, I don't know how you feel, but where we kind of almost feel like we want to weep when we hear the Jesus story. And that's a right thing. That's a good thing. But here's a weird question. At Easter, who does Jesus weep for? At Easter, who is Jesus concerned about? And there's another group of people on the other side of the sandwich here, not just the crowd, but there's another group. Did you notice? There's another group of people. And have a look at this next verse. So here's the other group. A large number of people were following him, including women who mourned and wailed for him. I'm convinced they're good-hearted women. They're intentionally good, and they are mourning for Jesus. And then Jesus, I just can't even get over this next line. Can you believe this? Jesus is right as this verse happens on the way to dying the most excruciating death. He right now he's staggering so much, he can't even carry the cross. Right? He can't even carry the cross. And in that moment, Jesus turns. Why would he do anything else except for look after himself? But all he can do is think about the people next to him. And this Jesus, he turns. And all he can do is he turns and he says to them, daughters of Jerusalem, do not weep for me. What? He looks at them and he says, don't weep for me, but weep for who? Weep for yourselves. Weep for yourselves and for your children. And he goes on to talk about that in the context of judgment to come. You can see. You see, the truth is, all of us are in the crowd saying, Jesus, we don't want you to have part of our life. And all of us are also people who, like the women, have to realize that we need to be able to weep for ourselves, because we need to understand that the result of this sin, the result of taking God out of the picture, is judgment, is death. You see, Jesus is there and he's like, you're weeping for the dead man walking, but really, I'm weeping. I'm concerned for you. You guys are all the dead men walking. And so all of us, you know what happens now. We need a solution, don't we? You feeling it? This is the heavy part of the sermon. We're almost done. We all need this. We all need a solution so desperately. And then comes this glorious passage in the middle here. You ready for it? Strap yourself in. Because this passage here in the middle is just, in my opinion, one of the most powerful pictures that we get in the Gospels in the lead up to Jesus' death. You know this guy Barabbas? This story is mentioned some stories are mentioned in some of the Gospels, not the other ones. Barabbas is mentioned in 1, 2 out of 4, 3. He's mentioned in all 4, right? Big part. Really, really big part of the Gospel story here. And Barabbas isn't here, and I want you to try and get your mind, I want you to jump into the story, if that's okay, MBM. I want you to work out, what does it look like to feel what is happening, to get inside Barabbas' shoes, to feel the scene. You guys ready to do that? Who's ready? All right, here we go, jump in. This is what it looks like. So if you look at the verses, what's happening is Pilate's calling together the chief priests, the rulers and the people, and he said to them, you brought me this man, This is talking about Jesus. You brought me this man as one who was inciting the people to rebellion. I've examined him in your presence and I found no basis for your charges against him. So what Pilate's saying here, he's saying, keep it up. What Pilate's saying here, he's saying, no question, ready? Jesus is innocent. Absolutely clear. And by the way, Pilate wasn't heaps like a big fan of Jesus either. Yet he says, even Pilate, who's a pretty weak politician, just quietly, right? He really bends over in a second. But he even says, Jesus is innocent. And do you know what he says next? And he and Herod, they didn't really get on traditionally. Way back, they have not got on. So this is a weird sentence. Neither has Herod. Herod thinks he's innocent too, he says. For he sent him back to us. And as you can see, he's done nothing to deserve death. And right now, it's really clear that Pilate says, Jesus is innocent. No question. So I want you to have no question in your mind tonight that Jesus is innocent, which is why verse 16 should really annoy you. This is like the worst judge moment. Look at this. It's like, Jesus is innocent, therefore I'll punish him. Right? What is going on, right? I mean, right now, already that is unjust. We haven't even got to the crucifixion scene where we know it's coming. You already should be feeling, this is ridiculous. Jesus is innocent, therefore I will punish him. And I want you to see what happens now. I want you to feel this. You're in the crowd. The crowd are getting, and you know what happens? The crowd outshout. They shout out Pilate. Pilate gives them a chance. He gives them a chance. He says, this guy's innocent. And the crowd won't have any of it. They want Jesus dead. And so they shout out over there. And you know what Pilate does? Pilate, man, interesting. He goes again. Have a look at this. Number two, he goes again. And the next verse that's up, he says this, wanting to release Jesus, Pilate appealed to them again. So that's number two. So Pilate goes two times, right? Here's your second strike. He really is innocent. I'm going to have another go. And then they shout him down again and they ask to be, they want him to be crucified again. Then have a look at this third, the third one. And so just in case you haven't missed it, you've missed it here. It says, for the third time, he spoke to them and he said, what crime has this man committed? I have no ground, find him no grounds for death penalty. Therefore, I'll have him punished and release him. So Pilate has said it three times. Do you know why? You guys are interested about this? Here we go. You know, the three times thing, that's the chapter before. Anyone know anyone who might have had three chances? Might have had three chances not to deny Christ? His name was? Peter. Right there. There was Peter before. And he had three things. Do you know this man? No. Do you know this man? No. Do you know this man? No. And then what happened after that? He wept bitterly. Peter had three. And we kind of look at Peter and go, but we're Peter. And we look at the crowd and go, they had three chances too, which ended in weeping too, by the way, with the women. And we're in the crowd too. And I want you to hear this, feel this mob. This mob is really going for it. They want death. And then Pilate has this idea. He knows about the tradition where he can let go one prisoner. And man, this story is full on. I want you to imagine this moment. And he thinks, you know what, this is great. He said, here's what he's going to do. One easy way to get Jesus out is to put before the people the world's most easiest multiple choice question ever. Right? I'm telling you, right? There are some tests that are hard and there are some tests that are not hard. And this is called an easy test, right? I'm Asian. I do tests. That's what I do, right? I like exams, apparently. But I tell you, you don't need to study for this one. This is multiple choice question, two answers, two options. Ready? He gets up before the crowd and he says this. All right, here's the deal. Easy question. Who do you want me to free? We have on one option A. Option A, Jesus, who has healed the sick, cared for the poor, loved the people, and is innocent. Three times I've told you. You can choose him to be free, option A, or option B, ready? A murderer. A really bad man. If you put all the gospels together, a murderer, definitely a robber as well. And you put that together and he goes, option A and option B, choose. And they absolutely lose it. They fail. This was unbelievable. They start chanting and they start saying, release Barabbas. We want Barabbas. Give us Barabbas. And all that happens, they start, the mob keeps going. They start yelling, crucify him, crucify him. Now imagine where Barabbas is. Backstage probably. There's Barabbas in the back. Now, what would you be feeling? Let's just take a moment just to think about this. If you were Barabbas right now, And by the way, getting into Barabbas' shoes is crucial to understand this. If you were Barabbas right now and you were on the way to crucifixion, I really believe that's what would have been happening. Barabbas would have had the cross. The cross that went on Jesus was supposed to be for Barabbas. Barabbas should have been there in that picture we've got with the three crosses on the mount. What we've got there, it should have been Barabbas in the middle with probably his fellow thieves and robbers on either side. And that cross, he would have been out the back looking at that cross probably in the corner, realizing that cross is going to go on him. He is about to die by excruciating pain. And I don't know what it would feel like. What would it feel like moments before you're about to be crucified? It would be petrifying. This guy would be absolutely petrified. And then he hears the chant, crucify him, crucify him. And he goes, this is it. And he's there in his chains. Can you imagine being Barabbas? He's there and he's locked up and he's in his chains. He's looking at the cross. He knows it's going to happen. He knows nails are going to go through these hands as he looks at them very, very soon. And there he is, this murderer, this horrible man who deserves all of this. And there he is, and he knows he deserves it. He's got it. He knows there's no way out. And there he is, all locked up. And then the guards come down. And he goes, this is it. And that moment, can you imagine Barabbas' moment when they come to him and they unlock those chains? And he says, he thinks, what's happening? And the chains unlock. And as those chains unlock off him, he looks again and they take those chains and they move over to the other corner where there's another man who's staying silent. Jesus, the Nazarene. And he takes those chains. The guards take the chains and they put it on Jesus and he looks there. And that cross starts moving along and they start moving that cross towards Jesus. And as those moments happen, it dawns on Barabbas, this is really happening. And can you imagine that moment when they say to Barabbas, you're free to go, go. What would it be like? What would it be like to understand that, to feel that? Perhaps he joins the crowd and watches Jesus all the way. And every time Jesus stumbles down, he thinks, that could have been me. That should have been me. Every time that happens, every time as Jesus moves towards the cross, that should have been me. And he looks at that every time he looks, he just got off. This is unbelievable. What would it be like to be Barabbas, to look at these free hands at that point in time? And you know, I tell you what it would be like. You don't even need to imagine it anymore, because I'm going to tell you tonight one really clear sentence, and I need you to listen up really carefully, because you don't even need to pretend to be him, because I'm going to tell you tonight, guys, you are Barabbas. 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 I'm Barabbas. Every single one of us are the same type of people. All of us, we've talked about, are sinners. All of us have got a judgment over our heads, which we just talked about. All of us know this is coming. All of us have no solution, except all of us are there and Barabbas. And that shock that Barabbas feels is the same shock that each of us should feel at Easter. In fact, we should feel it every day. Each of us at every point should be going, what? As we look at the cross, as we think, what? How? What? And if you've got numb to that, then that's not a good place to be in. My question for you today is this. Do you understand that you are Barabbas? Do you understand that it was your chains? That cross is where you're supposed to be on? But do you understand that Jesus took that? I was talking to my 9-year-old son the other day, and he was asking me what I was preaching on. So I'm preaching about Barabbas, and he said, it was a really interesting response. He normally just kind of talks a bit about it kind of lightly, but he said, that story makes me angry. And I said, yeah, I get it. And he said, I get really angry. I said, why do you feel angry? He said, because it's so unfair. It is so unfair. But you know what? You know what? There's a sense in which we all need to understand that. That if we don't understand that, we need to understand, the gospel, we need to understand that the gospel is unfair. It's a whole bunch of people who don't deserve to have that. A whole bunch of Barabbases that God chooses because he loves. You know, we don't know much about Barabbas. We don't find out heaps about what happens to him. But we don't presume that he followed Jesus and turned around. I mean, we don't have any moment where Barabbas kind of just turns to Jesus as he walks past and sort of goes, you know, oh, thank you so much. We don't have any of those moments. But I want to tell you tonight that that God's love for you is not dependent on your gratefulness. It's not dependent on whether you choose to respond to it. God loves you. He loves you. He loves you. He's given you his son. And this amazing thing happens because you are Barabbas. This amazing thing happens that, you see, the theologians have this big word for it. It's called double imputation. And basically what it means is this. It just means this, that what happened was a two-way transaction. Jesus died, listen to this guys, Jesus died so your sins go to him. But his freedom comes to you. His righteousness comes to you. As your sins go to him, that's one way. Not only does that happen, his righteousness, his freedom. His freedom goes towards you. And now you're treated as if you never did those things. God now looks at you and he accepts you and he loves you just as you are. And that's why this verse from Romans chapter 5 is so powerful. Because this verse up here is just one of my favorites. And I think it's the verse for us tonight. Next one, actually. Romans. You see, at just the right time, when we were still powerless, right? When we were still chained up, Christ died for the ungodly. Very rarely will anyone die for a righteous person, though for a good person, someone might possibly dare to die. But God demonstrates his own love for us in this. While we were still sinners, Christ died for us. While we were still sinners, that is what Christ did. You see, this Easter, when you look at the cross and you look at Jesus hanging there and you want to say, God, take Jesus down. Don't do that, not him. In a weird way, God says, no, him. And he says, I choose you to be free. You know, when you get your head around this concept that you are Barabbas, it really changes everything. It changes the way you live. You know, this morning at the 9 o'clock service and the 10 o'clock service, people kind of got 10:30 service, people got that and they changed their lives. I mean, even at the 9 o'clock service, one girl came up and talked to Dave Jensen and was crying and saying, I've just realized I'm Barabbas. I get it. And she gave her life to Jesus this morning. Which is amazing. And yeah, it's really, really amazing. Yeah, why not? For God. Because that's just amazing. And I want to say to you this, it really is as simple as that. It's who in this room tonight needs to get that, needs to realize that you are Barabbas, that you are the one who is locked up, you are the one who's chained, you are the one who should have died, but Jesus says, I choose you to be free today. Which is really interesting because I believe that what happened to that girl this morning is that she kind of got it. She got what was going on. And so what happened was she decided to respond really quickly. And I'm going to tell you about the last guy in this story that we haven't mentioned. Because as Jesus was falling over and couldn't carry the cross, there's this guy that's really fascinating. He's really quickly mentioned. Anyone know the name of the guy who took the cross for Jesus? His name was Simon. Simon of Cyrene. And so Simon of Cyrene, if you look at the verse here, what happened was, as the soldiers were leading Jesus away, they seized this random guy, Simon of Cyrene, who was on the way in from the country, and put the cross on him and made him carry behind Jesus. I mean, this is a weird day for Simon, right? You imagine Simon, he gets up this morning and he thinks, you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to make my way in from the country. That's what Simon of Cyrene's doing. Totally random. He's not a follower of Jesus. He's not connected to Jesus. This is just Simon of Cyrene who's on his way in from the country. That's what Simon of Cyrene's doing, right? That's what he's doing. And the soldiers go, you. And he's like, who? I'm just Simon of Cyrene going in from the country. And he says, this horrific scene that Simon's just happened to walk in on his way in from the country, tap him, grab the cross. And next thing you know it, Simon of Cyrene is etched in history as this picture of what it looks like this picture that's used and picked up all the way through the Gospels of what it looks like to follow this Jesus, that to so know that you are Barabbas, that you've been saved and set free, that your life looks like picking up your cross and following him. You know those verses. Picking up your cross, denying yourself, and your whole life looks like that. And that becomes a picture. And there's two things about Simon Cyrene that are really interesting. I mean, the first one is pretty much that, which is that it becomes the picture. Good old Simon Cyrene, totally randomly plucked out of nowhere, becomes this picture of what it looks like to be so convinced that you know what Jesus has done for you, that you will follow him no matter where you go. Now, you know what, guys? This is the real deal, right? Here's the deal. At Easter this time, so many of us are just going numb to this. We just go numb. I mean, I don't know if anyone's willing to say that you haven't even given Easter a second thought. I'm not trying to make you feel guilty. I haven't, right? I'm glad I'm preaching because it's made me think about it. Easter's in... Oh, when's Easter? This Friday, 5 days, right? Good Friday, 5 days. Have you had a moment to stop and think about how important that day is? Have you had a moment to stop and think, you know what, my whole life revolves around this moment? You know, Naomi and I quite recently got asked to go on this trip, and some of you heard about it, to go and minister to Christians who are being persecuted. And that was a weird trip, man, but I tell you what, it changed our lives. We got asked by this organization to come. They said, we want to take you and Naomi over to go and minister to the persecuted church. And we said, sure, where are we going? And that moment when they said to us, we want to take you and we're going to take you to a country called Iraq. And I remember thinking, that does not sound like a nice holiday. And then when they said next, we're going to be 10 kilometers away from the headquarters of ISIS. We're going to be right outside Mosul. We're going to be in a war zone, and you need to sign these documents that say that you understand that you may not come back alive. I remember getting asked that and going back home to tell Naomi. Naomi said to me, how's your day? And I said, look, we've been asked to go on a trip. And she said, fantastic. She said, we've been hoping for a holiday. And I said, how does Iraq sound? She was just like, what the, you know? And after lots of to-ing and fro-ing and getting advice and listening to advice and ignoring advice, we decided what to do. And we decided that we're going to go. And we left our four kids behind, which is a big deal, and we signed our wills off and all that kind of stuff, you know, donated them to MBM if anything happened. No. But, you know, all that kind of stuff. It was a full-on moment. And so we went over there to Iraq, and we went over there right near Mosul into the war zone thinking this is going to be crazy, and it was. I'm telling you, at one time we heard three bombs go off in 10 minutes, in the space of 10 minutes. It was intense. It was really close. It was really, really close. And I'll tell you what, we went over there thinking that we are going to be able to help these people and encourage them in their must be feeble faith. But I'll tell you what happened. We went over there and we met the people, and I am telling you, their faith, they really get that they're Barabbas. I mean, they really get it. There's no room for kind of a float in through an Easter service for them. They really believe that Jesus has set them free, that Jesus died for them, that he took his place, and they are so convinced of it that they take that all the way to the end. So we're in these refugee camps, internally displaced people, thousands of Christians in these camps who've all been persecuted by ISIS, who've lost friends, people have been raped, who've lost their... It's unbelievable. So I walked in there, and one of the first things we did, we talked to our translator. And I said to the translator, can you please just tell us any story? Tell us any story about what's happened. She's like, any story? She said, which one do you want to tell you? Where do I start? I'm like, there's heaps. She goes, I could go all day. So I said, just pick anyone. Pick the one on top of your mind. And she's like, okay. I guess I'm going to tell you. She goes, I'll tell you about my best friend. My best friend's my pastor. And I said, tell me, what happened? She said, well, my pastor, he's married. He's got some kids. He says, one day, some ISIS extremists swooped into the town and they took him. And she says at this point, which I'll still say to you, she says, I'll relay to you, she said, do you want me to go on? She could see me in my eyes thinking, what's going to happen here? I said, go on. And she said, what they did was they took my pastor, about 10 ISIS extremists, and they put him in a room. And they got him on his knees, totally outnumbered, 10 to 1. And they've got weapons. And they look at the pastor. And they say to him this: deny Christ right now convert to Islam. We order you to do that. Do you know what he did? I don't know, what would you do? I'll tell you what he did. He looked at each of them in the eyes. And he said, I will never deny my Lord. And they said it one more time. We're giving you one more chance. Deny Christ, convert to Islam now. And he looked at them again. He said, I will never deny my Lord. And so what they did was they moved towards him and they cut off his arms at his elbows. And as they cut off his arms and he's screaming in pain, they asked him to convert to Islam, to deny Christ. And you know what he does? Because this guy so knows that he's been saved, so knows that he is Barabbas. You know what he does? As his arms have been chopped off, what he does is he starts singing at them. And he starts singing hymns at them. He starts singing the hymns of Jesus on the cross. He sings right at them, and this infuriates them. And as he sings with the pain, they cut off his legs at his knees. And as they take his legs away from him, they've taken his arms away from him, he continues to sing at them even louder. And when they can't stop him singing, they cut out his tongue. And they take his tongue and they put it in his top pocket. And when they've had enough fun with him, you know what they did? They cut off his head. The translator, her tears are coming through as she tells me this story. And you know what they did? They took the mutilated remains of this body, of this pastor, and they put him in a black bag, canvas bag. And they took that bag and put it on a street corner. And then they rang his wife and said, we've decided to release your husband. Go and find him. He's on this corner. So the wife, who's been praying, some hope, runs over and finds the bag and opens the bag. And inside is the mutilated remains of her husband, except on top of it is a DVD. And it says, watch this. This is how we killed him. And do you know what his wife and kids are doing right now? Over on the outskirts of Mosul, I'll tell you what they're doing. What they're doing right now is they're preaching Jesus. What they're doing right now is their faith is so on fire that they're going around telling people about this Savior who's died for them. They know that they're Barabbas. They know what he's done. And so they pick up their cross and they follow him. Do you know why that pastor could do that? Because he took it that seriously. That picture of carrying the cross of Jesus. And you know what? This is understanding the depths of God's love at a level that we don't even get, to be honest. I'm just going to call it. I'm not going to insult you, but I'm sorry if I am. We don't get that. We can't even reach that. That's a story that we don't even have access to. It doesn't even fit with our brains. Do you know why? I tell you, it's really quite simple. They're not superpowered humans. They're not unbelievable, freakish saints. This is stories that happens to all these people I meet up there. All the stories where they've been raped or taken or kidnapped, all of them have this kind of thing that's going on over there. And let me tell you why it is. It all comes down to one thing. They really believe they're Barabbas. They really believe that they've been set free. They really believe that their whole lives need to be living in response to that. And that's what they do. And so I want to ask you, this Easter, is that what it's going to be for you? Is that what it's going to be for you? You know, the second thing about Simon Cyrene that's really interesting that you have to kind of do a little bit of puzzles to work out. But unlike Barabbas, who we presumed never kind of gave his life to Jesus, Simon the Cyrene, all scholars agree, that I've read anyway, all scholars agree that he did. If you want to know how you work it out, I'll give you a sneak peek. You can work it out because the Mark's Gospel says Simon, father of Alexander and Rufus, and that gospel was written to the church in Rome. And everyone knows that you wouldn't say that unless you know the family. And Rufus, and in the end, becomes a pillar of the church in Rome. And so we're absolutely convinced, if you just work the ages backwards and work out how it works, that we're convinced, the scholars are convinced, that somewhere, maybe even on that day, or very soon after, Simon the Cyrene, the random guy from the country, who got plucked out of this, who got to watch Jesus all the way and watched him fall over and watch him get executed and watch the whole thing happen. Somewhere there, that random meeting was not random. Nothing is random. But somewhere in there, he decided that he's going to follow this Christ. And you right now may think, this is random. I don't even know why I'm at church tonight. Or some of you are like, no, it's not random because that's what I do every Sunday. But it's not random because maybe tonight might be the night that you might have been coming to church for ages. But right now you think, you know what? I'm going to make this Easter the most significant Easter ever meeting because I'm going to actually for once in my life take this seriously. And I'm going to give my life to Christ just like Simon the Cyrene did. When are you going to do that? I'm going to show you a photo now that actually looks like a totally random photo because it's in a random place. But this is my lovely daughter, and I like her a lot. And her name is Caitlin, and she's 5 years old. And I'm taking this photo in a random place. This is a very random place. I'm in Carlingford Court car park. It's nothing special about Carlingford Court car park, let me tell you. And I'm not just taking a photo randomly here because I'm Asian and Asians take photos of everything, which we do. We've been taking photos since we come out of the womb, man, all the way. But I'll tell you what's going on with this photo. This photo is very special for me, and only took it about a week and a half ago. And I'll tell you why I took this photo, because I want to remember this moment. Because about 5 minutes before this photo, this little girl was walking to the car with me, and Naomi and the kids were in another car. And Katie and I were just walking, and we just come to the side of the car, and we're on the way home. I'm about to get her in the car, and I'm about to put the seatbelt on, and she stops me. And we're talking about something different, and I don't know what happened, but she just right then wanted to talk about something. It had nothing to do with the conversation before. And she said, Daddy, I want to talk to you about something. And I said, well, should we get the seatbelt on first? And she said, no, I want to talk to you about something. And I could tell from her voice, she was pretty serious. And when your five-year-old daughter, she puts on that voice, man, you move. And she said, I want to talk to you about something. So I said, what is it? And the words that came out of her mouth just absolutely stopped me. I could not believe what she said. She said, Daddy, I've decided I want to give my life to Jesus. And I said, I don't know whether to cry or to laugh or to hug her or, I don't know, dads don't get prepared for these moments. And I said, all I said was, okay. And I said, that's great. I said, when do you want to do that? She said, I want to do it right now. And I said, here in Carlingford Court car park? She said, yes, right now. I double check. You don't want to go home first? You want to talk with your mum? You want to do anything? No, I want to do it right now. So I said, okay, Katie, let's do it. It's a random place. We're in the car park. I said, hop in the front seat. So there's a little five-year-old girl. She hops in the front seat. I'm on the steering wheel side. She's on the other side. And then she climbs up onto the seat and she gets on her knees. And it was just this beautiful moment. And then she's on her knees and she said, how do we do this? And I said, well, we just pray. And so there's this little girl, this gorgeous little voice, and she's there and she's on her knees and she just says this, dear God, I'm sorry for my sins. Thank you, Jesus, for dying for me. Please come into my life and help me to follow you. Amen.